In the previous episode, I laid the groundwork for what I hope will become a reliable and versatile softbox. I designed the entire assembly in SolidWorks. From there, I began manufacturing everything from scratch. I repurposed a CPU heatsink to serve as the cooling base for the LED matrix. I also built a stainless steel reflector, shaping, banding, welding, and finally texturing the interior to maximize light diffusion. I followed that by fabricating a perforated housing for the LED driver using a 50 by 50 mm steel tube. Now it's time to take it further. In this episode, I'll solve the brightness control challenge and continue building the remaining parts of the softbox. So if you're curious to see how this project evolves, stay tuned. The most intricate work is still ahead. One of the key challenges in this project was to achieve adjustable brightness for the light source. Since it is a high-power constant current matrix, controlling its brightness is not as simple as reducing the voltage. What I needed to do was adjust the current flowing through the LED, because in these systems, brightness is directly proportional to the current, not the voltage. That led me into a deep dive through various methods, experimenting with different solutions, most of which failed. But every attempt taught me something. First, I tested a DC-DC buck converter on the output side of the constant current driver, hoping to step down the voltage and thus the power. But the moment I connected it, I realized this method wouldn't work. Because the driver is designed to regulate current, not voltage, it kept trying to push the same amount of current through the buck converter, regardless of the load on the other side. The converter itself didn't alter the current and the LED began to malfunction, just started blinking. Next, I tried inserting resistors on the input side of the driver to see if limiting the input voltage would affect the driver's output. But this approach also had critical flaws. The resistors I used started heating up significantly due to high power dissipation, and the LED matrix began flickering intensely. That was a sign that the driver was no longer operating within its designed voltage range. These experiments confirmed one thing. If I wanted precise and safe control over the light intensity, I had to modify the internals of the LED driver itself, not just patch something onto it externally. So I decided to take the hard road. I opened up the driver, removed the aluminum casing, and carefully dug out all the potting compound. After about an hour of careful work, I exposed the PCB. From there, I identified the current sensing resistors. These are very low ohm resistors, typically below 1 ohm, placed in series with the output to regulate the amount of current flowing to the load. These resistors are read by the internal feedback circuitry of the driver's controller chip, so increasing their total resistance results in a lower current output, which in turn dims the LED matrix. I desoldered these low ohm resistors from the PCB and soldered in two wires, extending them out of the driver housing. This gave me access to the sensing loop, allowing me to experiment with different resistance values externally. But I wanted more than a fixed resistance. I wanted step-based dimming, which could be toggled manually. So I designed a resistor array made of 5 resistors wired in series, each one connected in parallel with a switch. This means I can selectively short-circuit any resistor in the chain to change the total resistance in steps. More resistance equals less current, and that means less brightness. To calibrate the system, I built a simple test bench. I connected the LED matrix to the modified driver, and to it I attached a voltmeter to monitor the voltage of the matrix, an ammeter to read the real-time current, a temperature sensor to monitor the heat output, and in front of the matrix, I positioned a smartphone running a luxmeter app to measure the illuminance. With this setup, I began testing different resistor combinations and watched how they affected the current light output and heat generation. It took some time to find the sweet spot, but eventually I narrowed the usable range to between 0.18 ohms and 0.6 ohms. At 0.18 ohms, the LED was running close to full brightness, around 2.1 amps. At 0.6 ohms, the light was still usable, but the current dropped noticeably, and the thermal load was much lower. So now, using this custom resistor switch array, I've created a reliable and safe stepped dimming system. It's not software-based, and it's not controlled by a fancy microcontroller, but it's robust, repairable, and completely within my control. This solution may seem over-engineered, but for me, it represents the kind of hands-on problem solving that makes engineering so satisfying. Now it's time to move on to the next components from the drawings, the fan housing and the bottom cover. The fan housing will serve as the ventilation core of the entire softbox. It will house a compact cooling fan that ensures stable thermal performance for the LED matrix during extended use. The design allows for efficient airflow around the heatsink, while keeping the unit compact and rigid. As for the bottom cover, this part will be densely packed with functional elements. It will contain the main power button, the power socket, the series of toggle switches to adjust brightness, the power supply module for the cooling fan, and the external resistors that I previously pulled out from the LED driver for brightness control. I started fabricating the fan housing. I selected a mild steel sheet as the base material. Using printed templates from the CAD drawings, I transferred the outlines directly onto the sheet. After, I proceeded to cut the shape, using an angle grinder fitted with a thin cutting disc. To form the box-like shape, I used my manual sheet metal brake to achieve clean, consistent folds. After banding, I made a few relief cuts along the edges of the blank and manually fine-tuned the remaining angles by banding them over a square steel pipe to complete the shape. Before welding, I drilled all the necessary holes for mounting. Once the housing was bent into shape, I tacked the joints. To avoid burning through the thin sheet metal, using a filler rod, I welded in short spots, allowing the material to cool. The fan housing is finally welded up, and it looks not bad. Next came the bottom cover. For this piece, I used the same material and fabrication process: layout, cutting, banding, welding, and drilling. At this stage, I carefully marked all lines and hole centers. It ensured that I wouldn't lose any important details during the subsequent cutting and fabrication steps. After banding the blank into shape, I moved over to the drill press to create 6 precise mounting holes. These holes will later be used to fasten the bottom cover securely to the driver housing. Once the holes were drilled, I temporarily joined the two parts using 6 screws. This ensured perfect alignment and helped prevent any deformation during the welding process. Then I positioned the side covers in place and began welding the assembly together. With both components fully welded, I moved on to the grinding stage. I took a die grinder fitted with 60 grit abrasive disc and carefully started smoothing out the welds and refining the surfaces. Gradually, I stepped down the grit, working my way towards a finer finish. In the final stage, I used a Scotch-Brite disc to achieve a satin smooth surface, eliminating imperfections. Then I placed the heatsink on top of the fan housing and marked the mounting hole locations. After center punching each hole, I used the magic of editing to drill them more faster. After that, I test fitted the cooling fan. I tack welded two small mounting brackets directly onto the inner wall of the housing, carefully aligning them to match the fan's mounting geometry. Once the welds were cleaned, I positioned the fan in place to mark the hole locations. Then I drilled the two mounting holes and tapped threads for M3 screws. Next, I moved on to finishing the bottom cover. I started by grinding and smoothing out the welds. Then cut out the openings for the main power button and the power socket. After the rough cuts were made, I refined the shapes with a hand file. Finally, I sanded the entire cover by hand with sandpaper to remove any remaining imperfections. I used a step drill bit to create clean holes for the switches. The next components I fabricated from the drawing were the bracket and the mounting arm. The bracket allows the entire lamp to tilt and its angle can be locked in place using a wing screws. I made it out of steel using the same method as before, marking, cutting, bending and welding. For the mounting arm, I took inspiration from the hinge style mount used on GoPro cameras. It acts as a pivot joint, giving the lamp a wide range of adjustment. This part plays a key role in balancing the whole structure and ensuring it stays in the desired position. In the next episode, I'll move on to the final assembly.